Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Battleship Commander, The Life of Vice Admiral Willis A. Lee, Jr. by Paul Stillwell, narrated by Walter Dixon. Preface. Dr. Scott Mobley, a retired Navy captain who is now on the faculty of the University of Wisconsin, has studied naval history extensively. He put forth a convincing rationale for a biography of the largely unsung Admiral Lee. I think Lee loomed larger in his own time than now, but he has much to offer naval officers of today. During his career, Willis Augustus Lee, Jr. was highly respected within the naval profession. He had extensive knowledge of the sea, small arms, large caliber gunnery, tactics, electronics, ship handling, and coordination of ship and aviation actions. Along with that package, he possessed a great deal of common sense and leadership ability. His subordinates enjoyed serving with him. He also had an innate quality of mental brilliance. George Street, who was later awarded the Medal of Honor as a submarine skipper, served under Lee's command as an ensign in the cruiser Concord in the late 1930s. Street often used an evocative term that aptly fits Lee: bright as new money. Why, then, is Lee so little known in the 21st century, even though he was skilled operationally and served as administrative-type commander of all Pacific Fleet battleships during World War II? Several factors can help explain. His most important distinction was that he had tactical command during one of only two battleship versus battleship gunnery duels in the war. As the result of his leadership from the flagship Washington in November 1942, the Japanese lost the battleship Kirishima and were stymied in their efforts to deliver a pummeling bombardment of Guadalcanal. That victory was the turning point that essentially ended Japanese efforts to retake the island. Then, the role of fast battleships in a war that emphasized aviation-based offensive power was diminished, as they were usually forced to serve in anti-aircraft screens of aircraft carriers. That was instead of operating primarily as a battle line engaged in surface gunnery engagements, the mission intended for battleships, up to the beginning of the war. After Guadalcanal, circumstances denied Lee the opportunity for an even greater victory. During the Marianas invasion in June 1944, he declined to engage in a tail chase of Japanese heavy ships because his ships had not operated together tactically, nor did the Japanese pose a threat to the Saipan beachhead. Lee's ships were unable to participate in the wide-ranging and controversial Battle of Leyte Gulf in October 1944. Because Admiral William Halsey refused to permit Lee's ships to guard San Bernardino Strait in the Philippines, another battleship versus battleship encounter was averted. Had Lee fought and won that potential engagement, his reputation would have been more widely known. In addition, Lee's modest personality was one that avoided public recognition and acclaim. His goal was to fight and win, but he did not want to be lionized in the public media. He deliberately avoided the spotlight. Then, because he died only 10 days after the end of hostilities in August 1945, he was not around to serve in the post-war Navy, nor was he available to write a memoir, even though it is unlikely that he would have done so had he lived longer. The Navy did recognize his achievements by naming a destroyer leader, the USS Willis A. Lee, for him in the early 1950s. Though the service has often recycled ship names, no successor ship with his name has emerged after the scrapping of the first one. Because Lee was an Olympic medal winner as a marksman, for years, members of the Naval Academy rifle team have visited his grave in the Arlington National Cemetery on the Sunday nearest the anniversary of his death. This book is an effort to counteract Lee's relative obscurity in naval annals. My journey to this point started in 1969 when I received orders to serve in the crew of the battleship New Jersey as Assistant Combat Information Center Officer. Coincidentally, Lee was an early proponent of the value of CICs. When the opportunity came to join that ship, I began a project to read naval history because the New Jersey had made so much history herself, including serving as Admiral Halsey's flagship at Leyte Gulf. Once I reported aboard, I found and perused a copy of the ship's cruise book from World War II. One page depicted the four officers who had flown their flags on board the ship during the war: Halsey, Admiral Raymond Spruance, Rear Admiral Oscar Badger, and Lee. That awakened a flicker of awareness. Once my tour in the New Jersey ended, I returned to civilian life and made a special trip to Sioux Falls, South Dakota, to see the memorial and museum that honored the state's namesake battleship in which Lee had served. Still later, I visited the museum ship North Carolina, another of his wartime flagships, and a sister of the one in which he spent most of his time, the USS Washington. It was an honor to tour the North Carolina, especially the flag quarters in which Lee had lived and worked. In 1974, I joined the staff of the U.S. Naval Institute in Annapolis as one of the editors of Proceedings magazine. Annapolis gave me proximity to the wealth of naval history source material in the Washington, D.C. area and in the Naval Academy Library. Research for this book began in the autumn of 1975 with searches of the records and by engaging in interviews and correspondence with individuals who had served with Lee. The goal here is to provide a narrative portrait of Lee as a human being and as a naval officer. His entire life, not just World War II. Descriptions of how he interacted with people are important in delineating his character and personality. By nearly every account, he was a pleasant man with a sense of humor, sometimes coming across as quiet and relatively unassertive. In all likelihood, the Leyte Gulf fiasco was the most disappointing and frustrating experience of his life. The essence of the man was that he cared deeply about the naval profession. He enjoyed what it offered and what he could offer it. My research on Lee began more than 40 years ago, and I am embarrassed that the completion of the project has only now come to fruition. Many other books, articles, and oral histories intervened on my agenda in the meantime. I am particularly rueful that all but a few of those who provided information for this book are no longer alive to read the result they helped to bring about. On the other hand, I am grateful that the Admiral's story can now revive the reputation he acquired in his lifetime. In addition, as Captain Mobley suggested, the description of Lee's life can also serve as an inspiration to Navy professionals of this century. 1. Mischievous Moose in Kentucky, 1888 to 1904. For many years, long after he had left Owen County, Kentucky, Willis Augustus Lee, Jr. was still known by local residents as Mose. The nickname originated in the spring of 1888. Despite her advanced stage of pregnancy, his mother persisted in her pastime of fishing on Eagle Creek, which ran near the family home at Natalie. On 11th May, she stayed at it so long, in fact, that she had to be rushed home from the creek for the birth of what proved to be her second son. She joked afterward that she might name him Moses because she had taken him away from the water, just as Pharaoh's daughter had rescued the biblical Moses from his hiding place among the bulrushes of the Nile River in ancient Egypt. The baby was named for his father instead, but the nickname stuck. The father was a 35-year-old farmer and school teacher whose roots were in Kentucky. The baby's great-grandfather, Joseph R. Lee, had been born in the state in 1787, and his grandfather, Nathaniel W. Lee, in 1825. Nathaniel was a farmer and licensed distiller of bourbon whiskey. He operated a mill on Eagle Creek for grinding grain into meal and flour. The rural hamlet in which the family lived was known originally as Lee's Mill, and by 1888 had been renamed Nat Lee, a contraction of Nathaniel Lee's name. Nathaniel died in 1891. Nathaniel Lee's brother, thus Moses' great-uncle, was Grandison R. Lee, born in 1827. During the Civil War, he served as a Confederate soldier under General John Hunt Morgan of the 2nd Kentucky Cavalry Regiment and was captured during the war. Grandison later became a physician. He died in 1905. Both brothers were buried in Owen County. Grandison's great-grandson, Alan Meacham, wrote of Moses' grandfather, "Nat was an ardent Confederate, but necessarily inactive since it was his job to care for the farms. But at his distillery, he maintained a tavern where his daughters liquored up the Union soldiers to get intelligence as to Union activities." Nathaniel Lee's son, Willis Augustus Sr., was born in Owen County in 1853. He later married Susan Ireland Arnold, daughter of Elijah Arnold, an undertaker and attorney in the nearby village of New Columbus. The census of 1880 listed the population of New Columbus at 84. Natalie was even smaller. Owen County is an area of rolling farmland in north-central Kentucky, not far from the state capital at Frankfort. Its staple crop during the time young Lee lived there was burley tobacco, and farmers raised corn, alfalfa, and livestock as well. In 1890, the family moved about 15 miles north from the Natalie, New Columbus area to the county seat at Owenton, when W. A. Lee Sr. became the county judge. In the census of 1890, Owen County had a population of 17,676. Owenton was a town of fewer than 1,000 inhabitants. The town was dependent on the surrounding farmlands for its economy. It had barns for the storage of tobacco, and the usual facilities and services that made country towns natural meeting places. Courthouse, general stores, blacksmith, hotel, harness shop, barber shop, law offices, churches, and schools. As a county judge, W. A. Lee was the chief fiscal and administrative officer, handling such diverse matters as road building, probate court, and small claims court. A circuit judge tried civil and criminal cases, so that county court day, held the fourth Monday of each month, was a well-attended social event. It attracted horse-drawn buggies from miles around as their owners gathered to trade horses, meet their friends, and be entertained by gypsies and traveling medicine men. Judge Lee received a second four-year term in 1894, and then practiced law from 1898 until his death from a heart attack in 1931. He was also president of the People's Bank and Trust Company in Owenton, and served for a time as city attorney. Like the rest of his family, the judge had dark brown hair and eyes. He was of medium height and became portly as he grew older. His personality was much the same as the one his son displayed as an adult: quiet, uncomplaining, shrewd, reliable, and purposeful. He was friendly and got along well with others, but he was not the hail fellow well met type commonly known among career politicians. His wife Susan was a quiet person who, unlike her husband and children, spent much of her time at home. She suffered from heart trouble and died of a heart attack in 1913. The Lees settled into a two-story frame house at the corner of Roland Avenue and Seminary Street, about 1/8 of a mile from the county courthouse where Judge Lee worked. Out back of the home were a frame buggy house and an outhouse or two. Willis Lee Jr. had two older sisters, Lucy and Roberta, as well as a younger one, Alice. For a time, the family also included Mose's older brother, Clarence, who died of appendicitis when he was about 8 or 10. The household also included Mrs. Lee's brother, John Arnold, and a cook. The Lees led a comfortable existence and were considered among the better families in Owenton, though they were not social climbers. Certainly, they were among the most intelligent people around. All the children had excellent minds and did well in school, but they were not individuals to be bound by convention. They spoke their minds and did as they pleased, paying little heed to the gossip that followed. One subject of such talk was the family's failure to attend church. They were not attracted by the fire and brimstone preaching style of the Baptist Church, the most prominent denomination in Owen County. Lucy, the oldest sister, married lawyer James Vallandigham. They had a happy marriage that produced three children. Vallandigham was later a circuit judge. By contrast, the two younger sisters lived undisciplined lives and set the gossips to chattering with tales of their behavior. Judge Lee's tolerant nature expressed itself in a live-and-let-live attitude toward gambling and bootlegging in Owenton. It was also manifested in the loose rein he kept on his children, and helps explain why his younger son was allowed to become such a prankster. Mose was indeed mischievous, and generally, his pranks involved some cleverness. Mostly, young Lee played with other boys, but Florence Arnold qualified as an exception because she was a tomboy. On one occasion, Lee and his friends asked her to join in a scheme involving her horse Bill because she was an accomplished rider. The boys killed some snakes and tied them to Bill's tail. Then, Florence rode her horse through town with a group of boys running along behind. She stood in the stirrups and pretended to be frightened. The boys, young Lee among them, were calling such things as, "Help! Help! This horse is running away with this girl! He'll kill her! Help! Help!" As it was calculated to do, the stunt brought the women of Owenton out to see what the fuss was about. More than 70 years afterward, the horse's rider recalled the incident and the reaction of the witnesses. "When they saw the dead snakes, they wanted to kill every one of us and instructed us in no uncertain terms that we should know better than to find our pleasure in such things as running people crazy for nothing, even though it seemed fun to us." Her conclusion, which was probably especially true in the case of Mose Lee, "I am doubtful any of us profited by the tongue-lashing." On another occasion, Lee and his young male friends were walking along after obtaining a bag of caramel candy squares wrapped in paper. Some acquaintances saw them and asked for candy. They were put off for a time, until Mose and his companions were able to get a bar of yellow soap, which they cut into caramel-sized pieces and wrapped in the candy paper. After that, they shared the wrapped squares generously, to the consternation of the recipients. That was not the only time when Lee allowed something to be taken when it was other than what it seemed. He once was caught in school with a bag of Bull Durham tobacco in his pocket and the tag and drawstring dangling in view. The teacher confiscated the sack of tobacco and threw it into the school stove. Soon afterward, as if in demonstration that he had not learned his lesson, Lee again showed up at school with a tobacco sack in his pocket and the tag in view. The teacher took the second bag and pitched it into the stove, which then exploded. Lee had emptied the bag and refilled it with gunpowder. Afterward, he could claim, in a literal sense, that it was the teacher, not he, who had caused the explosion. A few black citizens lived in Owenton, and they generally got along well with the whites. The children of both races played together, even though their schools were segregated. None of Lee's close friends was black. Sometimes he and his chums teased and played tricks on Bill Lewis, a black youth who drove cattle to pasture. To the white boys, it was doubtless playful fun, but they sometimes taunted Lewis to such an extent that he got angry enough to throw stones at his tormentors. W.T. Forsey, who would many years later become president of the First National Bank in Owenton, went to school with young Lee. He remembered him as an uncouth youngster who was apparently oblivious to his personal appearance and what other people thought of him. Mose enjoyed the outdoors in that mostly rural area and took an interest in reptiles, bugs, and freaks of Mother Nature. Lee's friends learned to be wary of him because he might pull a snake, frog, or scorpion out of his pocket or some other hiding place and spring it on them. As Forsey put it, "In school, most of the boys were rather leery of sitting with him in the double seats which we had to occupy in those days, for fear of introducing something of the undesirable species right during school hours." Because he was bright, Lee generally did well in school. It was a family scandal, to use the words of his niece Elizabeth, Lucy Vallandigham's daughter, when Mose once flunked mathematics. He did so at Smith Classical School, a private institution he attended for a while, before switching to the public one. Everyone else in the family excelled in math, so it was probably a case of letting his mind wander to things in which he was more interested. As an adult, Lee demonstrated the facility for solving complex math problems and a tendency not to spend time on things that did not really interest him. In any event, his sister worked with him to correct the deficiency. One tale of Moses' days in Smith Classical School became a classic in the annals of Owen County, for some version of it turned up in nearly every account of Lee's boyhood. His unkempt appearance, which incidentally was to be a lifelong trait, even when wearing naval uniforms, caught up with him one day when school teacher Smith reprimanded him for having dirty shoes. He admonished Lee to go home and shine his shoes before he came to class again. The boy did so, but he did not leave it at that. He carefully pulled a paper bag over each shoe and tied the top of it around his ankle. This, he explained to Smith, was his way of making sure that his shoes would stay shined. Alas, the teacher was not amused and proceeded to give the boy a thrashing for his impudence. Lee's interest in wildlife was not confined to bringing animals to school. Once he was in a store when the storekeeper remarked jokingly that he wished he had a black snake as a means of eliminating a population of rats. When Lee showed up 3 days later, he reached into his pocket and pulled out a black snake, which he deposited on the merchant's counter. The boy also kept a large squirrel cage in his backyard. From his ventures into the surrounding woods, he caught squirrels and kept them in the cage that was 6 feet high and 10 feet across. Sometimes as many as 10 squirrels were in it. Many times, though, Mose shot at forest creatures rather than bringing them back alive. One occasion did not turn out so well. Charles Yancey of Owenton recalled the time Lee encountered a skunk. The skunk did what skunks do, and Mose's clothes had to be burned afterward. Charles's brother Evan later served with Lee in the cruiser Concord in the 1930s. Judge Lee was an excellent shot and passed the knowledge of shooting along to his son. Many years afterward, Alan Kamak, who was a boyhood neighbor of the Lees, recalled that Mose seemed to have both an unlimited amount of ammunition and an unlimited enthusiasm for shooting it. Lee developed remarkable proficiency with small arms, and his interest in guns remained with him, both personally and professionally, all his life. While in Owenton, he was sometimes called upon to rid the courthouse grounds of sparrows, and when there were no live targets to shoot at, he aimed at inanimate ones. Kamek's sister, Louise, said of Lee that he was an unusually bright boy who was born with a built-in sighting device and a shooting arm. Anything Mose aimed at, he hit. Among his targets were the neighbors' window panes and the cupolas, lightning rods, and weather vanes of the well-to-do. Once, he fired through an upstairs window in the Kamek house. Fortunately, Louise's sister Eleanor was not in the room, because the bullet shattered glass all over Eleanor's dolls, and her playhouse was near the broken window pane. The boy's curiosity and familiarity with guns brought problems of another sort. One of his chums was a boy named Roy Holbrook. Lee's niece said of the two of them, "They were always in trouble together." One of the two of them decided to make a bomb. They took some gunpowder out of shotgun shells and put it under a tin can. Then they ran a trail of powder from the can as a fuse and lit the other end of it. Nothing happened for a while, so they went to investigate. When Mose got close, the bomb exploded in his face, and for a while there was some fear that he would lose his sight. The physician who cared for him was able to save his vision and treat his burned face so well that he had no permanent scars. From then on, however, Lee had damaged eyesight and wore thick glasses much of his life. Given his restlessness and adventurous nature, it was understandable that young Mose would seek something beyond the confines of Owenton. He could not see himself being cooped up with law books, even though his maternal grandfather, father, and brother-in-law were all attorneys. Instead, he sought to go to the Naval Academy. A friend who knew him at the time offered the opinion that he probably sought the opportunity to leave home because nothing in Owenton interested him. Judge Lee's political connections in the overwhelmingly Democratic county were sufficient to gain Mose an appointment to Annapolis through Congressman South Trimble. He headed for the academy in the spring of 1904, when he had just turned 16 and had not finished high school. Despite his intelligence, some in town questioned whether he would succeed at the rigidly disciplined academy, given his penchant for unconventional behavior. As former neighbor Louise Davis put it many years later, "The strict rules and regulations were tough on Mose, but he stuck it out. This is the only thing he did which surprised the townspeople," who by then had probably lost nearly all capacity for surprise where he was concerned. They had kind of expected him back somehow. 2. Naval Academy Years, 1904 to 1908. Willis A. Lee's civilian existence ended on 9th July, 1904. Up to then, he and Oscar Smith, a Pennsylvania teenager, had been temporary boarders in Annapolis. They stayed at Miss Emma Atwell's house on Prince George Street, opposite Carville Hall Hotel. For many years, the hotel provided housing for midshipmen's dates when they came to town for dances and other social events. Smith and Lee took their oaths as midshipmen together that July day. When Lee arrived at the academy, most midshipmen lived in the new quarters. New was a relative term in this case, since the structure had been completed in 1869. It was a four-story, red-brick building with an illuminated cylindrical clock tower rising above it. In 1901, construction began on a much more modern gray granite building, Bancroft Hall, in the then-popular Beaux Arts style. The designer was noted architect Ernest Flagg, who produced a building that had dormers, a mansard roof, a center section with a rotunda, and two wings of rooms for midshipmen. The first occupants, including Lee's plebe class, moved into a wing of Bancroft in 1904. That original structure, completed in 1906, was designed for subsequent expansion and now has 8 wings. When Lee was there, the student body numbered fewer than 1,000. Now, it is more than 4,000. One thing that Oscar Smith prized about his relationship with the Kentuckian was that the Christmas boxes Lee received from home made his room a popular visiting spot. Years afterward, Smith wrote, "I still savor the delicious taste of the country hams that were always found among the gifts. In those days, there was no Christmas leave for midshipmen, and the Christmas boxes were treasured by many a homesick boy in Bancroft Hall." Mark A. Mitcher from Oklahoma was a midshipman who entered the academy as a plebe in 1904. Another mid from that state, Peter Cassius Marcellus K. Jr., had bilged out the year before for failing academically. The upperclassmen started ragging Mitcher as a surrogate for Cade. Mitcher had to repeat the name of the departed mid whenever asked. The strange upshot was that Mitcher thus acquired the lifetime nickname Pete. Mitcher struggled academically, and he was also held culpable in a hazing scandal. In November 1905, midshipman James R. Branch died in a fight among classmates. Investigation revealed that 200 mids had been involved in hazing. Mitcher was compelled to resign, both for his part in the hazing and for the numerous demerits he accumulated. Even so, the young man was permitted to return to Annapolis and graduated in 1910, 2 years after Lee. Their paths would cross frequently 40 years later in the Pacific. Lloyd C. Stark from Missouri was another plebe classmate. He graduated in 1908 and remained in the Navy until he resigned in 1911. He went home to join the family apple business and later was in combat as an Army major in World War I. He entered politics in 1928 and served as governor of his home state from 1937 to 1941. In 1940, he ran for the U.S. Senate and lost to Harry S. Truman. After his tenure as governor, he returned to work in the family nursery. Stark's time as a plebe is of interest because he left behind a diary of September and October 1904. Doubtless, he took part in many of the same activities as did Lee. Among them were sailboat drill, steam launch drill, and time on board the USS Chesapeake, a wooden-hulled, 3-masted bark with auxiliary steam power. She was renamed Severn in 1905. According to Stark, the plebes rowed racing cutters and performed infantry drill and bayonet practice in the armory. Naturally, there was small arms marksmanship practice as well. Further exercise included boxing, gymnastics, fencing, and swimming. All this was prelude to academic studies in the fall. At one point, Stark recorded his weight as 137 pounds. Photos of Lee from the period indicate that he too was skinny. Nicknames were de rigueur at the academy for many years, and the Kentucky native soon became Wah Lee on the basis of his initials, W.A. He also acquired another nickname that stuck for the rest of his life. John Earl, a fellow plebe, explained, "Lee was given the name Chink by his classmates early in plebe summer because, vaguely, he looked a bit like a Chinaman. About average in size, he had a round face, eyes that were slightly slanted, and skin yellowish in tone." As the years passed, the nickname was modified to the less offensive Ching, though many of his conferees stuck with the original version. Lee spent part of the 1905 summer training cruise on board the Nevada, which he joined on 3rd of June. She was a shallow draft, low freeboard monitor with a main armament of 2 12-inch guns. On 15th July, he transferred to the Hartford. She was an old sailing vessel, a steam sloop of war. She had been Admiral David G. Farragut's flagship during the Civil War Battle of Mobile Bay in 1864. During one stop of the summer, Earl Buckingham and Lee were on liberty together in Rockland, Maine, and they passed a laundry with a sign that said, "Wah Lee." Buckingham and another midshipman persuaded Lee to ask the laundryman how to render the name in a Chinese character. Thereafter, Lee used the character as an alternate signature. During 3.5 of his 4 years at the Naval Academy, Lee roomed with Edmund Randall Norton. The roommate marveled at Lee's ability to get by with little studying. Norton himself worked hard and stood second in the 201-man graduating class of 1908. Even though he had a great mind, Lee applied himself only to those things that really mattered to him. Norton observed that the two main categories that appealed to Lee were rifle shooting and freehand drawing. John Earl marveled at Lee's ability for intense concentration. He remembered that Lee could read a lesson assignment once and retain everything of importance. Earl wrote of Lee, "He never seemed to be in the least burdened by our studies, as were so many of us. On walking into Chink's room, one seldom found him in his books. He was particularly good at math, our hardest subject, and spent many hours trying to make dumb classmates see how simple math really was." Earl observed that Lee appeared to have a limited social life. He did not recall Lee being conspicuous at dances, adding, "I am sure he was much more interested in firearms than girls." Another classmate, Worrell Carter, was destined to have a substantial role in logistics support for the fleet in World War II. Years later, Carter recalled Lee's drawings. Even though Lee and his future wife would have no children of their own, Lee was fond of children and drew sketches to entertain them. As Carter remembered, "My own children had a great fancy for him." Just after the class of 1907 graduated, Lee began his final summer of training. During the cruise, Lee and a classmate, Walter Heiberg, were assigned to the monitor Nevada. Other ships in the training squadron were definitely second line: the monitors Arkansas and Florida, and the cruiser Olympia. The latter had been Commodore George Dewey's flagship during the Battle of Manila Bay 9 years earlier. The squadron was at Hampton Roads, Virginia, for 10 days in June to visit the Jamestown Exposition. The exposition lasted throughout much of the year. This World's Fair commemorated the 300th anniversary of the founding of Jamestown as the first permanent English settlement in what eventually became the United States. During their ship's visit, Lee and Heiberg were often on the exposition's midway. The pair closed down several shooting galleries that hung silver dollars from strings. At a price of 10 cents per shot, the marksmen won the dollars whenever their bullets snapped the strings. They were so successful that, according to classmate John E. Meredith, this was long the subject of conversation in the wardrooms of the fleets. As Meredith pointed out, the feat was mentioned in Heiberg's entry in the 1908 Naval Academy yearbook. John E. Eisman, a classmate, wrote, "When in company with classmate Andrew Denny, we were looking over the shooting galleries on the midway. Whenever we stopped, the proprietor begged Ching to help himself to any of the prizes, but refrained from shooting up the place." At the end of the 1906 to 1907 academic year, the school awarded prizes for general excellence in target practice. The recipients were Willis Lee, gold medal, his friend Andrew Denny, silver medal, and his exposition partner Walt Heiberg, bronze medal. From Virginia, the Nevada proceeded to New England. While the ship was in New London, Connecticut, Lee received orders to report to the Academy rifle team in Annapolis. When he was detached from the ship on 12th July, momentous events lay ahead. After undergoing practice at the Naval Academy, on 5th August, he joined other marksmen for the National Rifle Association-sponsored national matches. The site was Camp Perry, named in honor of Commodore Oliver Hazard Perry, who won a signal victory in the Battle of Lake Erie during the War of 1812. The camp was a National Guard training facility in northern Ohio, on the shore of Lake Erie. It was the first year the matches were held there, the result of efforts by the state's Adjutant General, Brigadier General Ammon B. Critchfield, who sought to improve the marksmanship of Ohio soldiers. Shooters fired towards the open water of the lake. In between, an earthen berm held the targets. As he took part in the competition, Midshipman Lee had a ragamuffin appearance, far from the standard he was supposed to display at Annapolis. He was clad in a sailor-type wrinkled white uniform that bore his last name on the chest, a nondescript hat, and a cartridge belt. What he accomplished in one day was astounding. He won individual national championships in both rifle and pistol. Lee was the only American ever to win in both categories in the same year. In the individual rifle category, as opposed to team competition, he was one of 684 contestants. He performed rapid fire at 200 and 300 yards, and slow fire was at 600, 800, and 1,000 yards. Even though he missed two targets at the maximum range, he eked out the victory over Lieutenant W.H. Clopton, Jr., a cavalry officer, 318 to 316. With the pistol, he shot slow fire, timed fire, and rapid fire at ranges that ran from 15 yards to 75 yards. In that case, he beat out his nearest competitor, 238 to 237. His classmate, Thomas C. Kincaid, talked with Lee after the triumphs at Camp Perry. Lee told him that he had finished the rifle competition early, so he entered the pistol matches, just to kill time. Clearly, he accomplished more than that. William Ward Poco Smith was also on the Naval Academy team. Smith wrote of Lee, "As an expert rifleman and pistolman, he might have been called a nut on this form of sport." On one occasion, when they were shooting together, they were engaged in rapid-fire mode with bolt-action rifles, 5 shots in 20 seconds. Then Lee pulled what Smith termed a stunt during a match to determine who would make the team the following day. While Lee was shooting at a target 200 yards away, a dog ran across the field, halfway between the firing line and the target. Smith reported, "Ching's rifle left the target as he sent his 5 shots at the dog, but nothing could keep him off the team." Because of his vision problems, Lee used different pairs of glasses while firing at different ranges. Once, while firing at 1,000 yards at Camp Perry, Lee confided, "Poco, at this range I cannot see the bullseye. The entire target looks the size of a postage stamp." Smith observed that Lee aimed at the postage stamp and hit the bullseye. Classmate Eugene Wilson was also a member of the rifle team. He emphasized that successful shooting by the Navy men was the result of effective teamwork. Members shot in pairs and coached each other. The rifleman firing the shot was responsible for the correct elevation of the piece, while his partner provided help on deflection, that is, coaching on horizontal aiming. He did so by observing the way the wind moved the flags on the range, heat waves, clouds, and other factors that would affect the flight of the bullet during its trajectory to the target. Years later, John Earle, a fellow member of the rifle team, wrote to Lee's widow, "Lying prone in the boiling sun on the rifle range, through binoculars, I would spot Chink's shots for him as he fired at long ranges. Then he, in turn, would do the same for me." He recalled that Lee often paused to wipe the sweat from his eyes and polish the lenses of the shooting glasses he wore. He also attested, as have many, that Lee was not flustered. As evidence of Lee's skill, Earl wrote, "I have seen him shoot chippy birds out of a bush with a Colt's 38, 1, 2, 3, 4, just as fast as he could pull the trigger." One of Lee's lifelong traits was his becoming sense of modesty. During his first class year, he was in the same company with midshipman William Curfus, who was a plebe at the time. Curfus explained that weekly personnel inspections were standard operating procedure. Midshipmen wore their full dress uniforms, including medals. Lee did not comply, so the inspecting officer asked him where his medals were. Lee made an excuse that they were being repaired or something else. The inspector finally lost patience and told Lee that if he did not show up with medals at the following week's event, he would be put on report. "The next Sunday," remembered Curfus, "Lee did appear in formation, with his chest so covered in medals that it was difficult to see his jacket." Poor eyesight dogged Lee throughout his naval career. He wore thick glasses and was always concerned about passing the vision portion of the annual physical. His classmate, Thomas Kincaid, wrote that Lee memorized 2 lines of the eye chart that was no closer than 20 feet from a midshipman being tested. More than 50 years after they had been at the Naval Academy together, Kincaid wrote that he still recalled the sequence of 2 vital lines, FLOTDEXC and CLVFOTZE. Once, when Lee and Kincaid were walking together, Lee's vision was so poor that he was unable to recognize his roommate from across the street. As for personality, Kincaid remembered Lee as unruffled and imperturbable, and added, "I don't ever remember seeing him angry, nor anyone else angry at him." Eugene Wilson of the rifle team knew Lee well. Like Kincaid, he shared his midshipman recollections more than 50 years after the fact. Wilson recalled that Lee habitually failed the regular eye exam. The procedure called for a retest of those who flunked. By virtue of his name's place in the alphabet, Wilson took the regular exam near the end of the line. He was thus able to let Lee know which chart was in use that day. Lee could then recite the day's sequence of letters during the retest that followed right after the regular one. Remarkably, after all the intervening years, Wilson in 1962 recalled one line of letters that matched Kincaid's memory, FLOTDEXC. Reaching ahead to discuss Lee's 1942 achievement at Guadalcanal, Wilson added, "When I heard the news of Chink Lee off Savo Island, I felt justification for the little deceit we had perpetrated on the physical exams at Annapolis." Among Lee's cartoons in the 1908 yearbook was a self-portrait that showed him with tousled hair, large rim glasses, a big grin, and a chest full of medals. The latter were for his shooting prowess. Accompanying the sketch was a limerick. "This is a heathen Chinee who is otherwise known as Wali. Take a look at the chink, and you surely will think how jealous old Zimmy must be." The last line was a joking reference to Lieutenant Charles A. Zimmerman, bandmaster at the Academy since 1887. In 1906, he composed the music for Anchors Away, the Navy's unofficial anthem. In May 1908, not surprisingly, the Bureau of Medicine and Surgery reported that a physical examination of Midshipman Lee revealed that he had defective vision, a potentially disqualifying condition. His right eye tested at 11/20 and his left eye at 10/20. Nonetheless, the Navy's Surgeon General recommended that he be allowed to graduate with his class, subject to re-examination 2 years hence to determine his physical fitness for the service. The Office of the Secretary of the Navy concurred in the decision. On June 5, 1908, Lee and his classmates graduated after 4 years of study, drills, training cruises, and a generally confined life within the walls of the Naval Academy. Of the 201 graduates, Lee stood a middling 106 and was among the youngest. He had turned 20 less than a month earlier. His only younger classmates were Harry M. Hitchcock, born 7th June 1888, and Lee Pettit Warren, born on 20th June. Hitchcock was the youngest midshipman, admitted at the age of 16 years, 8 days. Lee, who did not finish high school, was also among the youngest admitted at just under 16 years, 2 months. The level of attrition had been considerable in the years since he arrived. 82 of his original classmates did not make it to graduation. 3. Junior Officer, 1908 to 1918. According to the practice of the era, graduates of the Naval Academy were required to serve 2 years in the probationary category of past midshipmen. The class of 1909 was the final one in that category. Starting in 1910, Academy graduates became ensigns upon graduation, though still ranking in seniority behind the new ensigns who graduated in 1908 and 1909. On the day after his class graduated, Lee had not far to go for his first assignment. After leaving the midshipman dormitory, he moved several hundred yards to the old sailing ship Severn, namesake of the river in which she was berthed. Lee and his classmates first encountered her as the Chesapeake during seamanship training in their plebe year. For Lee, she provided a temporary home as he practiced with the Navy rifle team. He spent most of July and August with the team at Camp Perry, Ohio, the scene of his 1907 triumphs. That was not his first choice of duty. On 1st June, shortly before graduation, he had asked to compete for a spot on the U.S. team that would participate in an international rifle tournament in Bisley, England. The Bureau of Navigation, which directed personnel assignments, summarily turned him down. After he finished in Ohio, Lee spent 30 days of home leave in Kentucky. He was now ready to join the seagoing Navy, though his first ship turned out to be a lemon. He reported to the battleship Idaho on 2nd October 1908. She was brand new at that point, having been commissioned on 1st April. The ship was 382 feet long and displaced 13,000 tons. The British battleship Dreadnought, eponym of a new type, had entered service in 1906 and set a new standard for battleships with her main battery of all big guns. The Idaho mounted the standard pre-Dreadnought armament of 4 12-inch guns, 8 8-inch, 8 7-inch, and 12 3-inch, and 2 torpedo tubes. It was truly a mixed bag. Not only that, she was built on the cheap. Previously, Congress had provided basic characteristics so that each class would have the best armor, armament, and speed. But in 1905, in authorizing the Idaho and her sister Mississippi, Congress restricted the tonnage, making them less capable than their predecessors. Battleship historian Malcolm Muir wrote that the two sister ships proved a perfect example of false economy in defense spending. They were of such limited endurance and so slow that they hampered the performance of the whole fleet. The ship's wardroom comprised about 36 officers, including past midshipmen such as Lee. In November of that first year, Lee was assigned to engineering duty. The ship could generate 10,000 shaft horsepower with two triple-expansion reciprocating engines. Fuel, as in all navies at that point, was coal. The Idaho could muster a top speed of only 17 knots. Lee joined the watch-standing rotation in port and underway. A few months later, on 22nd February 1909, the ship was part of a large naval review at Hampton Roads, Virginia, to celebrate the return of the Great White Fleet to the United States. President Theodore Roosevelt had dispatched a squadron of battleships on a trip around the world. The title of the group came from the hulls, painted white, rather than the gray of the Spanish-American War. The superstructures and masts were tan in color, known as buff at the time. The circumnavigation was a test of operational capability and logistics support. International diplomacy was also involved, as American sailors and officers mingled with citizens of other lands. Roosevelt was on hand to welcome the fleet home. It was his swan song as a naval-oriented president. He left office on 4th March. Lee's tenure in his first ship ended in May 1909, when he returned to the rifle team and the Severn in Annapolis. His prowess earned him repeated spots in that capacity over the years. Indeed, he continued his small-arm shooting and coaching throughout the remainder of his life. An Academy classmate, Bill Brereton, related an incident that demonstrated Lee's ability and coolness. During their time together in 1909, Navy shooters were trying out for the pistol team. Brereton wrote, "Lee had what was probably an overloaded cartridge in his revolver. At any rate, his piece blew apart, which he was firing. He turned to the guy behind him, after throwing down his gun, and said, 'Dan, lend me your gun. I want to finish this string.' He finished the string with his left hand. His other was injured, making all bullseyes." The competition for which the team was preparing was the annual meet of the New England Military Rifle Association, held at Wakefield, Massachusetts, in late July 1909. Lee's friend, Andrew Denny, won the Vaughn Revolver re-entry match at 25 yards, and Lee won the Sears Timed Fire Revolver match at 50 yards. Denny was the overall winner in the pistol competition. The Boston Globe crowed about the beautiful weather and the quality of the competition. From Massachusetts, Lee proceeded to Camp Perry, Ohio, for further shooting. Lee next spent a brief period on board the Independence, a former warship originally commissioned in 1814 as a square rigger. She was the U.S. Navy's first ship of the line, that era's equivalent of a battleship. By 1909, she was a receiving ship at Mare Island Navy Yard in Vallejo, California, north of San Francisco. In that role, she was a floating barracks that provided berths for those stationed at the shipyard and for transients such as Midshipmen Lee, Heiberg, and Denny. Receiving ships were common in that era, before the Navy had established considerable infrastructure ashore to house and feed men in transit. Often, they were old warships that were long past useful roles in the fleet. Lee then joined the protected cruiser New Orleans, which was being refitted at Mare Island for China service. A protected cruiser was one that had armor above her machinery spaces, but not the side belt armor that characterized a similar type known as an armored cruiser. The 3,769-ton ship had a main battery of 6 6-inch guns. She had been built in Britain for the Brazilian Navy. In March 1898, with the Spanish-American War in the offing, the U.S. Navy bought the ship. She was renamed New Orleans and participated in the war off Cuba that soon followed. From 1899 to 1904, she was the flagship of Commander Cruiser Squadron, U.S. Asiatic Fleet. She was decommissioned in 1905. Lee's friend Eugene Wilson, another member of the class of 1908, was also at Mare Island. He was assigned to the destroyer Hull, which was undergoing overhaul. The young Academy graduates, rifle team alumni, received overtures from an agent of a potential expedition. He sought to recruit them to overthrow the Manchu government in China. The inducements included fantastic sums to resign from the Navy and become sharpshooters for the adventure. Wilson remembered, "As a final offer, he guaranteed us the right to chop off as many Chinese heads as might suit our fancy," an offer that somehow did not appeal to Chink Lee at all. Instead, Lee and Denny were part of the cruiser's crew when she was recommissioned on 15th November. From California, the new shipmates ventured across the Pacific and arrived at Yokohama, Japan on 25th April 1910. She then patrolled in various Far Eastern waters. It was a reprise of the ship's earlier service in the Asiatic fleet, and it was Lee's first in-person exposure to China. The New Orleans had served mainly as a seagoing taxicab to get the young men overseas. Though he was by no means a prolific writer, Midshipman Lee, along with his co-author, Andrew Denny, got an article published in the first 1910 issue of the U.S. Naval Institute, Proceedings. The topic was revolver shooting, and certainly the two of them were well qualified to offer instructions. The 6-page article was a primer on the subject and included hand-drawn diagrams to illustrate the shooter's desired stance and various views of the grip. Though the illustrations did not carry Lee's name, one was identified by his signature in a Chinese character. The approach was that anyone could learn to shoot well. One tip was, acquire accuracy before you try for speed. Then came this advice. Remember that the revolver is a very dangerous weapon, especially when not loaded. Presumably they were referring to a pistol believed to be unloaded. It was the only proceedings article either of them ever published. On 6th June 1910, 2 years and 1 day after his graduation from the Naval Academy, Lee was commissioned as an ensign. Surprisingly, when he took his promotion exams for what was then termed final graduation, Lee flunked the navigation section with a mark of 2.16. He passed the re-exam held on 7th December of that year. The New Orleans had delivered Lee and Denny to Hankou, China, near current-day Wuhan, where they joined their next ship on 26th May. The Helena, commissioned in 1907, served in both the Yangtze River Patrol and South China Patrol. She was distinguished in appearance by a tall foremast and a tall smokestack. The latter helped disperse the heavy black coal smoke that came from her boilers. She was 251 feet long, 41 feet in the beam, and had a shallow draft of 9 feet for navigating China's rivers. Her main armament consisted of 4 4-inch guns. The purpose of the collection ships in the area was to protect U.S. interests in the Far East. Typically, the locus was known as the China Station, though the ships operated elsewhere as well, often in the Philippines. Some sailors homesteaded with the fleet, remaining there for tour after tour. Lore had it that such extended tours made a man Asiatic, suggesting perhaps that he had slipped out of the mainstream and was inclined to behave oddly at times. For a young officer who sometimes signed his name with a Chinese character and went by the nickname Chink, such an assignment seemed natural. It was also natural that he did a lot of shooting. In 1911, he crossed paths with one of his Annapolis classmates, Ensign Philip Seymour, who was then serving in the crew of the Pompey, a torpedo boat tender that arrived in Shanghai after a tour on the Yangtze River. Lee's ship was in port at the same time, so he visited the Pompey. Seymour told him of an indoor rifle range ashore. Lee wanted to go there for practice if he could find some ammunition. an officer who frequented the range, had a supply and agreed to lend Lee a few boxes of 22 caliber bullets. The next day, Seymour learned that Lee had been stricken with cholera and hospitalized ashore. As his classmate recalled, "For a few days, everyone was apprehensive and worried because, among cholera patients, very few recovered. However, I am glad to say he recovered in a short time, and everyone felt relieved." Marine Second Lieutenant Adolph Miller, a shipmate who joined Helena in 1911, was a year behind Lee and Denny at the academy, though he didn't graduate. He described the pair as inseparable friends, gold dust twins. Once Miller was part of the crew, the ship ventured in April of that year from Shanghai to Hankow because of rumors of a revolution between the Manchu government in Shanghai and the rest of the huge country. The revolt broke out in October in Hankow, where the ship was in port at the time. A landing force comprised of a company of Marines and two divisions of sailors went ashore from the Helena to protect American interests. The Imperial Army came south and clashed with the revolutionaries at Hankow. Those in power prevailed in the struggle. In his role as an intelligence officer, Miller was ashore for 5 months, and Lee commanded a division of sailors. During the 5 months of fighting, Miller kept a day-by-day record of the revolution. He and Lee joined in compiling a report that went to the Office of Naval Intelligence in Washington. Their further endeavors at looking after American interests involved what Miller called an international cocktail tour. He and Lee made many liberties together in Shanghai and Hankow and at other ports on both sides of the Yangtze, all the way to Yichang, 1,000 miles away. Their other activities included trips to China's interior to hunt for tigers, bustards, and pheasants. Around 1912, Lee and other members of an assembled team challenged people in various ports to rifle and pistol matches. Ensign Harold C. Train, who graduated from the Academy in 1909, reports years later that he believed the Americans always won. On 29th January 1913, the Helena detached Lee with orders to return to the United States at the end of his tour. He took passage on board the Collier Abarenda. He boarded her at Shanghai, China, and rode her to Nagasaki, Japan, and then to San Francisco. In April, he reported to the battleship New Hampshire, but in June left for temporary additional duty with the Navy Rifle Team, for which his services were so frequently needed. The event was another series of matches in Wakefield, Massachusetts. Next was another stint at Camp Perry, Ohio. Afterward, he reported to a receiving ship, the USS Franklin, in Norfolk, to await the arrival of the New Hampshire. The Franklin had originally been commissioned as a screw frigate in 1867. On New Year's Eve of 1913, after spending more time on board the receiving ship, Lee returned to duty on board the New Hampshire, which was herself already obsolete. She had been commissioned in 1908 and had the dubious distinction of being the U.S. Navy's last pre-dreadnought battleship. She was 456 feet long, displaced 16,000 tons, and mounted a main battery of 4 12-inch guns. She also had 8-inch and 7-inch guns. In early 1910, the Navy had commissioned its first dreadnoughts, the South Carolina and Michigan, which were virtually identical to the New Hampshire in size and tonnage, but mounted 8 12-inch guns apiece. One of Lee's new shipmates was a young enlisted man, Quartermaster Third Class Arthur J. Sweetman. Years afterward, he remembered the New Hampshire as a happy ship with a fine complement of officers. He recalled a distinct line between officers and enlisted men, but not a sense of resentment. It was simply the way of life, said Sweetman, and it was one that did not sanction fraternization between the two groups. The routine required the enforcement of discipline, and it produced an efficient ship, the watchword of the time. One means the crew had for keeping in shape while on board was to pace the deck. A privilege granted to those with less than a year to go was being able to walk athwart ships, that is, from side to side. All others had to pace fore and aft. Sweetman added, "Looking back, this seems rather childish, but at the time, it was an unwritten law that was strictly adhered to." For amusement, while not on duty, crewmen played blackjack and shot craps. There was a written regulation against gambling, but somehow the officers never seemed to come around at the right time to catch anyone. Frederick J. Egger, another enlisted man in the crew, was in the 2nd Division. The division officer was a lieutenant known as Dopey Shea. Egger did not recall the officer-enlisted divide as being so dramatic as Sweetman did. He wrote, "Lieutenant Shea evidently transferred to the ship after a tour of duty in China and did not have that dignified attitude toward the enlisted men that officers did in those days. In fact, he hung out with the crew at every opportunity." In Egger's recollection, a friendly rivalry existed between Shea's division and that of Lee. Their crews manned whaleboats in a rowing contest won by Shea's men. Rumor among the crew were that the officers had a $50 bet on the outcome. Shea was so pleased with the result that he sent a boat ashore to buy bushels of mangoes and treated his men to mango-flavored pies and ice cream at his expense. Lee, for his part, kept up his compulsive shooting. Egger recalled that the officer whom he referred to as Bullseye Lee would send crew members to the galley to bring up empty cans. Two crew members tossed cans into the air simultaneously, and they seldom fell into the sea intact. From June to December 1913, the New Hampshire joined other ships of the Atlantic Fleet in patrolling the Gulf of Mexico. The purpose was to protect U.S. interests, especially because relations were strained between the United States and Mexico. Sweetman said that there was no liberty for the ship's crews because of ill feeling toward Americans. When not steaming, the ship sometimes anchored off Veracruz and sometimes ventured to Tampico. On one return to the Veracruz area, he and his shipmates spotted the collier Cyclops, which caused dismay. Loading the battleship's coal bunkers was hot, dirty, and onerous. It was unpleasant, but necessary until oil became the standard fuel. In February 1914, the New Hampshire was operating in the vicinity of Cuba, as the Atlantic Fleet typically did during winter months. Lee was due to be examined, both physically and on professional subjects, for promotion to lieutenant, junior grade. He was concerned about his ability to pass the vision portion of the physical. Ensign Lee deliberately objected to having the eye exam ratified at the Norfolk Navy Yard unless he was there in person. He would not settle for the results of an exam held on board his ship in January. Events dictated that Lee's examination be postponed because the New Hampshire had pressing business elsewhere, Mexico. The atmosphere worsened in the spring of 1914 when an international incident blew up and led to hostilities. 9 American sailors went ashore in Tampico and entered an off-limits fueling station. The Mexican government arrested and later released the sailors. Rear Admiral Henry T. Mayo, commander of the Atlantic Fleet's 4th Division, demanded an apology and a 21-gun salute. He got the apology, but not the salute. The situation was complicated when the Americans learned of the delivery of weapons to President Victoriano Huerta, who had taken control of Mexico the year before in a bloody coup. U.S. President Woodrow Wilson ordered a landing force to go ashore at Veracruz and seize the weapons from the local customs house. On the morning of 21st April, landing parties began going ashore from various ships. At that time, there were no amphibious landing craft designed for the purpose. Instead, the ship's whaleboats, normally used to carry crewmen on liberty, were towed to the port, where the sailors and Marines clambered onto the land with orders to occupy the customs house, railroad terminal, and communications offices. Initially, the landing was unopposed. That night, Rear Admiral Frank Friday Fletcher directed that the sailors and Marines expand their occupation beyond the port area to the entire city. That was too much for the locals, who began attacking the Americans. Captain Edwin Anderson, skipper of the New Hampshire, went ashore in command of the 2nd Seaman Regiment. Quartermaster Arthur Sweetman was with him to serve as signalman. The situation devolved into urban warfare as the outfit marched toward the Mexican Naval Academy in parade ground formation and came under fire from locals. Anderson's men, out in the open, were convenient targets. The U.S. ships offshore then bombarded the academy. Into this hostile mix went Lee. He had shot at many things, both animate and inanimate, in his life up to then. Now, Mexican snipers were on the menu. The snipers rarely showed themselves, sometimes poking out only a rifle barrel or a hand holding a pistol. Getting targets to respond required risk, but Lee baited them. During a lull, he sat on a curb, in the open, with a borrowed rifle across his knees. As Arthur Sweetman's son Jack artfully put it years later in a book, Lee went ahead, engaging in a competition in which there were no return matches. Contingents of Marines later showed up and brought the city under American control. Lieutenant Colonel John A. Lejeune, who later served as Commandant of the Marine Corps, was among those in command. Captain Anderson wrote of the junior officer, "Ensign Lee was in the position of commanding the 2nd Company of Seamen on the occasion of the occupation of Veracruz. He displayed extraordinary heroism in rescuing a wounded man under very heavy fire from rifles and machine guns. He handled his company with conspicuous skill and courage throughout the entire engagement consequent to the occupation of the city and, subsequently, during the stay of the naval forces ashore." Afterward, the New Hampshire steamed to New York, where Lee received a visit from his Naval Academy classmate, John Earle. Earle wrote of the experience, "I remember having lunch with Chink aboard his ship in the Hudson River upon his return from the Mexican War and listening to his tales of picking Mexicans off the rooftops at Veracruz." As the modest Lee said to him, "Oh, I guess I got a few of them." The would-be snipers were silhouetted against a bright sky. He said he drew a bead on a Mexican at perhaps 800 yards, pulled the trigger, and then watched as the man crumpled into the street below. As part of the visit, Lee went to his stateroom and pulled open a drawer crammed with shooting medals. As Earl put it, "They made my eyes pop." In July, when the ship had moved to the Norfolk Navy Yard, Lee again renewed his request to be examined by a statutory board for promotion, and he passed. The following month, while World War I was breaking out in Europe, Lee went on 30 days leave. Perhaps he wanted a chance to wind down after dealing with all the bureaucracy involved with his promotion exams. Finally, on 29th September, he was commissioned a lieutenant, junior grade, with his date of rank set retroactively as 6th June 1913, more than a year earlier. For seniority purposes, he had been an ensign for 3 years, and now he could finally wear the insignia of his new rank and collect the difference in back pay. After he served in the battleship another year, while the United States was steadfastly neutral during the European War then in progress, Lieutenant, junior grade Lee, was detached from the New Hampshire on 3rd December 1915, a few days after Thanksgiving. After a period of leave, he reported on 9th December to the Union Tool Company, a foundry in West Chicago, Illinois. There, he served as Naval Inspector of Ordnance. It was his first shore assignment, 7.5 years since his graduation from the Naval Academy. The company's low-slung factory had the look of a warehouse, utilitarian rather than aesthetic. Lee's role was to act as a quality control observer. The location also served as a base from which he traveled to other sites that held Navy contracts. In January 1916, for example, the Bureau of Ordnance, BUORD, authorized the young officer to make repeated trips to the Cutler Hammer Manufacturing Company in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. There, he inspected control appliances for turret motors that were long lead-time equipment for battleships of the Tennessee class. Other travels took him to Minnesota, Michigan, Indiana, and Iowa. Obviously, factories in the Midwest were making their contribution to the construction and arming of ships that would operate on oceans far away. A letter of 16th March 1916 from the Bureau of Navigation, later the Bureau of Personnel, was the good news, bad news type. "You are advised that the Naval Examining Board before which you recently appeared found you mentally, morally, and professionally qualified for promotion, and recommended you therefore. The Board of Medical Examiners found you not physically qualified for promotion because of myopia, and recommended that you be further examined physically in 6 months in order to ascertain whether the present extent of your incapacity still exists at that time." The saga continued in January 1917, when Lee traveled from Chicago north to the Naval Training Station at Great Lakes, Illinois, to be examined for promotion. The Bureau of Medicine and Surgery in Washington reported by radiograms to the Bureau of Navigation and to Great Lakes that the defective vision in Lee's right eye was 12/20 and his left eye 10/20. Both could be corrected to 20/20 with glasses, and the medical examiners recommended that Lee be granted a waiver. The answer was slow in coming. So Captain Anderson, his skipper in the New Hampshire, sent a rousing letter on Lee's behalf. He noted that while Lee was in his ship, he was impressed by the young officer's ability to pick up objects, such as sails and lights. In war games, he was an excellent night spotter in spotting enemy torpedo craft. As a capper, Anderson wrote, "Lieutenant Lee was in command of a company of sailors at the capture of Veracruz, and I personally observed him kill with a rifle two snipers who were firing upon my command after the other men of his company had failed to stop them." Another former New Hampshire officer, R.Z. Johnston, chimed in with a letter that echoed Anderson's. He said of Lee, "He wore glasses and appeared to be dependent upon them, but with glasses on, he was very reliable." Still more support came from Captain Richard H. Jackson, who was Lee's commanding officer in the gunboat Helena. More and more paperwork flowed, red tape in overdrive, and Lee again underwent examination in September 1917. The waiver was granted. Finally, a letter from the Bureau of Navigation on 19th February 1918, after the nation had been at war since 6th April 1917, advised Lee that he had been appointed a lieutenant. His persistence and the recommendations of senior officers with whom he had served paid off. This time, the retroactive date of rank was 29th August 1916. Remarkably, Lee did not even need to get his uniforms restriped as a lieutenant. Things were moving rapidly for a Navy involved in a war in Europe and the Atlantic Ocean in between. A letter of 19th April, this one from Secretary of the Navy Josephus Daniels, notified Lee that he was temporarily appointed a lieutenant commander, with a date of rank 1st January 1918, a time when he was still wearing the uniform of a JG. 4. World War I and Aftermath, 1917 to 1920. In July 1917, while he was still going through the hassle of trying to get promoted to lieutenant, Lee was transferred to another shore billet. The United States had entered World War I 3 months earlier, and it still needed ordnance inspectors. One does not have to use much imagination to believe that a seagoing officer such as Willis Lee would have preferred to serve on board a warship that was going over there to support the Allied war effort in Europe. The new job was in a town on the Mississippi River, all the way across the state from Chicago. His new base of operations was the Root and Vandervoort Engine Company in East Moline, Illinois. It was a temporary geographical change that was to have a profound effect on the rest of his life. In 1918, at a party in Moline, he met an attractive young woman named Mabel Allen. She was vivacious and had a sense of humor, qualities that were bound to appeal to the young officer. Margaret Allen described her sister, Mabel, as being slightly over 5 feet tall and having brown hair and a pink complexion. Lee became increasingly smitten. The company to which Lee was assigned had started business at the dawn of the 20th century to provide engines for the fledgling auto industry. In 1910, the company introduced a new engine with an intriguing name, the Moline Dreadnought. Among the vehicles powered by the Dreadnought was a luxury car, the Moline Knight. With the coming of World War I in 1914, Root and Vandervoort got into the munitions business. It began producing projectiles and guns for the British, and constructed additional room in its factory to keep up with demand. After the contract with the British expired, the company put its equipment in storage until the U.S. Navy contracted for the production of projectiles and naval guns. As the situation had been when he was based in Chicago, Lee's duties carried him to a variety of locations involved in producing war materials. Perhaps the farthest afield was a trip in the autumn of 1918 to Fort William, Ontario, Canada. His role there was to check on the bore sighting of 4-inch guns furnished by the U.S. Bureau of Ordnance for French minesweepers. This also included teaching the French Navy men how to bore sight the guns. On 7th October, soon after the Canada trip, Lieutenant Commander Lee submitted a request to be assigned to sea duty in European waters. He made the point that he had been serving on shore duty for nearly 2 years. 2 days later, the ordnance inspector in Chicago wrote a favorable endorsement and said he had a potential relief for Lee standing by to be transferred to East Moline. Lee's request was granted. He was detached from the inspection job on 1st November. He took with him an identification certificate that reported he weighed 164 pounds, stood 5 feet, 10.5 inches, and had brown hair and brown eyes. Lee proceeded to New York and caught a ship to Queenstown, Ireland, which was then an active port for U.S. Navy ships. From there, he went to Brest, France, where he reported on board the four-stack destroyer O'Brien on 20th November. But he had arrived too late for an opportunity to take part in World War I combat. Hostilities had ended 9 days earlier. Lee was detached from the O'Brien on 18th December and ordered to temporary duty at U.S. Naval Headquarters at Brest. On 21st December.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.